Lord thy God in vain. Remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day. Honor thy father and thy mother. Thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet. Bless the Lord who forgiveth all our sins. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread, which gives life to the world, evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to please be seated and invite the children forward. So the children, if they were here today, would be talking about sin. Ooh, I like that little response there. We have some children here. Now, what we do in church is take a bath, and we take a bath together. Who says church isn't fun? I can remember as a child taking baths with my sister, and my parents would discover us because the water would be flowing out into the hallway underneath the bathroom door, because what we would do is soap up the edge of the bathtub, sit at this end, push off the wall, and slide all the way down. And sometimes a little water got splashed out. But I really enjoyed baths. I think baths and showers are the best modern convenience of all time. And I can tell you, I feel born again every time I take a shower. Sometimes, if I've got something going, maybe I'm sharing too much information, I don't know. Turn the camera off, Joyce. What? Too late. So sometimes if I gotta come back after doing something here and do an activity at night, I'll go home and take a shower and I'm born again and ready to start again. That's really what I want to focus on, because we are washed clean in the waters of baptism. We are washed clean by coming here on Sundays. We're washed clean by taking Eucharist. This is about getting clean. It's not a place where we focus on sin, although during Lent, we focus on sin and repentance and turning around and taking daily baths and taking weekly baths together. So try to think metaphorically, would you? Thank you. Are we ready for the readings? Hit it.
I love this church. Old Testament reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Christians in Ephesus, which I think is in the New Testament. In any case, there is a highlighted spot where you respond. I encourage you to do so enthusiastically and with great joy. Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light.
Light. Through, I find out what is pleasing to the Lord.
Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. The word of the Lord.
Did you notice the nod of the head? I like that, Pat. The word of the Lord. Can I see some nods? The word of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. So we have a new marketing campaign now. In light of what I just said, marketing committee, pay attention. The advertisement will be come and bathe together. Okay, that's all.
The response this morning is Psalm 23, found on page 612 of your Book of Common Prayer. Please respond on the half verse. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He revives my soul. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil.
For you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me.
You have anointed my head with oil, and my mouth is ready for.
Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
More. Whenever you read a story in the Gospel of John, okay, you can stand up. Can you stand and listen? Whenever we read a story in John, the writer of John is telling a story for a reason. And there are many different meanings, both on the surface and below the surface and below the surface that's below the surface. So your job this morning, after the gospel's read, I'm going to go around and find out what things you heard in this reading. And remember this, the writer of John says at the end of the gospel, many, many other things Jesus did that I could write about, but I've written this so that you can believe and have eternal life. So he put this story together in such a way that our response is belief and receiving eternal life. So please pay close attention. I want to get all the themes. I want to make sure, and I'm not asking Cammie one of them. You don't count. Trouty, you can't answer either. All right. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. As he walked along, Jesus saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then the man went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, man who used to be. Some were saying, others were saying, he kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him. He answered, the man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him,
where is he?
He said, I don't know. They brought to the Pharisees, can you raise that up a little bit? They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, but others said, and they were divided. So they said to the blind man, what do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened. And he said, he is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received the sight and asked them, his parents answered, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He'll speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age, ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, the man answered, I do not know whether he is a sinner. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples? Then they reviled him, saying, you are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as far as this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, here's an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, you were born entirely in sins and are too, and you're trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out. And when Jesus found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? The man answered, and who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. The man said,
Lord,
and he worshiped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we're not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say we see, your sin remains."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Was that story a little bit long? Well, it's the longest story in the New Testament. So it must be pretty important. Why do you think it was important? What did you hear? What were some of the themes, the many themes you heard? God did not cause the blindness. Let's get that straight. Jesus is saying that this person was not born blind because of sin of anybody. That doesn't mean there's not sin in the world, but the popular theology of today, I mean yesterday, is that if something's wrong with you, it's your fault. That sin must have been involved either in the way you were raised or who you are. We still carry that theology today. And this combats that theology, as does the entire book of Job, which is the longest poem in history other than the Odyssey, probably. What else did you hear? So I heard something about believing Thomas. Sorry, Stephen, you haven't been here long enough. But he said doubting Thomas, but go ahead. What did you say?
That there was a corollary with Thomas, the apostle.
In that they wouldn't believe?
Well, he said Jesus told him, those people that don't see and believe in me, blessed, they're blessed. They can't see blind regardless of what you find.
I'm very impressed, man. You know your scripture. So most people know about Thomas and doubting and all that, but they don't remember the line that Jesus says, blessed are those of you because you see, but blessed are those who don't see. And so seeing and blindness is a whole theme in this whole thing, both the person's blindness and the Pharisees' blindness and our blindness. What other themes did we hear? Yes, Claudia.
Well, this is probably different, but even after
I'm not
he...
I'm bothering you, Rich, am I? Go ahead, Claudia, speak. Great.
Even...
I love you, man.
I love you, too.
Even after... That's really close. Even after he was healed, the Pharisees, they still didn't believe that he was worthy of being healed. He was born a sinner, and he's going to stay a sinner, and how many times do we see that in our life?
You're stuck with that reputation forever. There's this scene that one of the commentators mentioned. You know me, I've always got to mention a movie. How many people have seen The Life of Brian? Okay, that's good. Well, there's this scene where, so Brian is always mistaken for Jesus, and this guy comes hopping up to Brian and says, "Help a person previously a leper." Why is he begging? Well, because he didn't have any other training, but he was used to being a beggar, so he stayed a beggar. Always makes me wonder about those home improvement shows where they clean up somebody's house or build a new house. I want to see it 6 months later. All right, what other themes? So the theme being, sometimes you're stuck with your reputation no matter how much you try to prove otherwise. And there they would, they wouldn't even believe their own eyes or ears that this person could see. I once was blind, but now can see. I'm thinking my own life, going from blindness to sight. I grew up in the Episcopal Church, hearing scripture read all the time, didn't pay attention to anything that I was aware of, certainly don't remember any of those academic erudite sermons. But when people prayed for me to receive the Holy Spirit and to receive Jesus in a new and unique way, suddenly my eyes were open because scripture just came flooding back into me, and suddenly I could read scripture and see insights I'd never paid attention before. Yes, I was blind, and then I saw. All right, any other themes? Light and dark. Who said that? Shannon? Very good. Light and darkness. That's all through the gospel, and it was in the epistle today. Live in the light. Don't live in the darkness. Focus on the wonderful things there are in the world. Quit looking at that junk online. Quit watching the junk on television. Hey, I've preached on that twice now. Maybe by the end of Lent, you'll turn off the TV. Ooh, now that would have been a good thing for a discipline in Lent. Next year, no television for any Episcopalian in all of Casper. Oh, I love it. All right, any other themes? We're almost finished. That was a long story. We got to have a short sermon. Yes, Audrey. Don't break the rules. Don't break the rules. That's the theme. Jesus healed on the Sabbath, and they're saying, don't break the rules. But as we know, from The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, C.S. Lewis, which our book study doesn't like, there is a deeper magic that goes beneath those rules. And yes, you can heal on the Sabbath. You can love on the Sabbath. You can shout hallelujah on the fourth Sunday in Lent. That's why I'm wearing rose today for the second time. No wonder I'm enjoying Lent so much. I should go to confession for that. All right, Trouty, any insights that have not been mentioned yet? Hey, she listens to me. I'm giving you permission to talk. No, Cammy, anything we left out? God's grace available to everyone. No matter who you are, no matter how you were born, and no matter what day of the week it is. See, you had to preach today after all. It was her day off. Light. God's glory being manifest. You know, I was reading Augustine's commentary on this story, and he still focused on sin, but the guy was not born blind then because God planned to heal him later. That's not really how I interpret it. I interpret it as all are created to reveal the glory of God, no matter how you were born or what time of the week it is. And yes, Cammy gets the last word. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I need you to hold this again. I remind you, please, I invite you to please stand for professing our faith. Remind you that we're using the word trust during Lent. We'll turn this way. We trust in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We trust in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, True God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We trust in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Prayers of the people can be found in your bulletin. You're invited to continue standing or sit or kneel. I invite you also to please utter your prayers out loud if you feel so led.
We pray for the church.
Pray for our presiding Bishop Michael or Bishop Paul Gordon. Our clergy. And we lift up Jordan, who will be ordained next week.
We pray for the countries of the world.
Mexico, Malawi, and Russia.
We pray for all creation.
That we would be great stewards of it.
We pray for those who are sick or in need.
Pamela. Continued healing for Morris and Susan and Karen and Laura and Jack.
We pray for those who have died.
Lord, we give you thanks that you're a person that we can talk to and pray to. We thank you for hearing our prayers. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we do pray.
Amen.
Amen. You know what? We really need to confess our sins. You really need to confess your sins, and I need to confess mine. I invite you now to turn to page 360. In the Book of Common Prayer. 360. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Step out here. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is a true saying and worthy of all to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And if anyone sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the perfect offering for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. I invite you to please stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you. I invite you to please be seated, and for those with birthdays and anniversaries, you can come down and be ready to be prayed for.
Good morning. I'm representing your fellowship committee, and Wednesday is a soup supper being hosted by the worship leaders and the Daughters of the King. So I know that there are some really good soup makers in that group. So come and enjoy. Starts at 5:30 with evening prayer. Soup from six, soup and breads from 6 until 6:45. And then
we're doing a program on different parts of ritual and worship. And this particular week, it'll be on baptism. Last week, we did the Eucharist.
So come and enjoy. Thank you.
And speaking of ritual and worship, we have a secret code in the Episcopal Church, and it's hidden inside that big red book in your pew. So Tuesday's theology class is to decode the secret book and help you surf around and see what's what and where is what. So please come Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. Youth group day today meets at 12:15, and then next week we'll meet at 12:15, and we're headed to the mountain for some snowshoeing and other fun things, so any teenagers are invited to that. And speaking of young people, we have a new name for the coffee hour host, And thank you to Dustin for coming up with the name Coffee Acolytes. We're looking for Coffee Acolytes to sponsor the coffee hour. And we're really looking for people with solid knees, solid backs, no arthritis, that you can see and that you can hear. In other words, we'd really appreciate some younger members of the church stepping forward, and we have some older ones who will train you. Typically, the coffee pot's already done by Trouty by the time you get here, but you'll serve coffee and whatever wonderful cinnamon rolls that Stephen Delger brings. And they're and Susie Delger, okay, Susie did it. Stephen won the pie contest last week. So trust me, I'm just going to leave when the service is over. You can find me at the cinnamon rolls. This afternoon at 4 o'clock, we set some chairs out here. We have the cello playing, and we reflect on scripture and share that reflection, and then we lay hands on people that need special prayers, and we end with the Eucharist. Remind you that every Friday we have the Stations of the Cross here, including Good Friday. And remind the vestry we're meeting Monday night at 6 o'clock in person and online, and I'll send the agenda out today. Are there any other announcements? So I'm guessing birthdays. You'll find the birthday prayer in your bulletin or on page 830 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Happy birthday. Now ascribe unto the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings, and come into his courts. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father, for creating us and cleansing us. And so we join the saints and angels in proclaiming your glory as we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Father, we especially praise you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to heal us. And so, Father, we bring you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Father, we now celebrate the memorial of your Son. By means of this holy bread and cup, we show forth the sacrifice of his death and proclaim his resurrection until he comes again. Gather us by this holy communion into one body in your Son, Jesus Christ. Make us a living sacrifice of praise. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Amen. Come around here.
The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Okay.
The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation.
Christ, the light.
I invite you to open your prayer books to page 366 or your bulletin to the post-communion prayer. Come on up. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. As I researched for our Lenten program, so many liturgical scholars said this communion has blessed you already. So the peace of the Lord be always with you. Let me start that over again. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you to pull out the blue hymnals for our final hymn.
Thank you.
times like these, I'm glad we sing all the verses. Thank you, Beverly. I had a post-it note on here to remind me that there are Easter envelopes at both narthexes, and email or call the office if you'd like to donate Easter lilies for Easter. Now let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. You're all sinning by saying alleluia during Lent.
It's Sunday. Alleluia.